We begin now part two of FirstAid Embryology. If you require further assistance, please refer to Falcon Online. We begin our discussion with heart embryology. Embryonic structure, and then what these structures give rise to. Truncus arteriosus gives rise to ascending aorta and pulmonary trunk. Bulbous cortis, right ventricle, and smooth parts, referring to the outflow tracts, of left and right ventricles. Primitive ventricle, portion of the left ventricle, primitive atria, trabeculated left and right atrium. Left horn of sinus venosus gives rise to coronary sinus. Right horn of sinus venosus gives rise to smooth part of right atrium. Right common cardinal vein and right anterior cardinal vein give rise to superior vena cava. Let's take a look at truncus arteriosus in greater detail. Neural crest migration, truncal and bulbar ridges that spiral and fuse to form the aortico pulmonary septum, giving rise to ascending aorta and pulmonary trunk. What would happen if something went wrong? Transposition of great vessels, failure to spiral, tetralogy of Fallot, overriding aorta, ventral septal defect, right ventricular hypertrophy, pulmonary stenosis, all part of tetralogy of Fallot, skewed aortico-pulmonary septum development, persistent truncus arteriosus, partial aortico-pulmonary septum development, interventricular septum development. So, let's take a look at the illustrations below and find out what the development is. Number one, right atrium, left atrium, interventricular foramen, and the aortico ventricular canals. There is a muscular ventricular septum. And number two, you'll have the spiraling that we had spoken of earlier. Number three, membranous ventricular septum develops. So number one, muscular ventricular septum forms. Opening is called interventricular foramen. Number two, aortico pulmonary septum meets and fuses with muscular ventricular septum to form membranous intraventricular septum, closing intraventricular foramen. Number three, growth of endocardial cushions separates the atria from ventricles and contributes to both atrial separation and membranous portion of the interventricular septum. Pathology. Membranous septal defect causes initial left to right shunting, initial, which then becomes right to left shunting. This is known as the Eisenmenger complex. Eisenmenger complex is described in detail when we go into or when cardiovascular chapters are covered. Now we'll go into interatrial septum development. Number one, orient yourself with where we are. Right atrium, left atrium, septum primum, dorsal, endocardial cushions. Foramen primum narrows as septum primum grows towards endocardial cushions. Perforation in septum primum forms foramen secundum. Foramen primum disappears. Foramen secundum maintains the right-to-left shunt as septum secundum begins to grow. Septum secundum contains a permanent opening known as the foramen ovale. Number five. Foramen secundum enlarges and upper part of septum primum degenerates. Number six. Remaining portion of septum primum forms valve of foramen ovale. Number seven. Septum secundum and septum primum fuses to form the atrial septum. Finally, the foramen ovale usually closes soon after birth because of increased left atrial pressure. Pathology: patent foramen ovale, caused by excessive resorption of septum prime and or secundum. Let's take a look at fetal erythropoiesis. The following locations of fetal erythropoiesis are yolk sac between 3 to 8 weeks, liver between 6 and 30, spleen 9 to 28, bone marrow 28 weeks onward. The mnemonic, young liver synthesizes blood. Please keep in mind that fetal hemoglobin is two alpha chains with two gamma chains. As the fetus develops, becomes an infant, gamma chains now is replaced by two beta chains to have hemoglobin A, alpha beta. We will now move our discussion to fetal circulation. Please orient yourself with the illustration on the left. The dark box, highly oxygenated blood. The white, less oxygenated blood. Please notice the aorta, the direction it is moving in. Please notice the inferior vena cava, the placenta, and the vessels that are moving out, two umbilical arteries, and one umbilical vein, and we'll begin our discussion. Blood in umbilical vein is approximately 80%, saturated with oxygen. Umbilical arteries have low oxygen saturation. Remember, this is one of the exceptions. There are three important shunts. Blood entering the fetus through the umbilical vein is conducted via the ductus venosus into the inferior vena cava to bypass the hepatic circulation. The liver hasn't developed yet. In order to pass, bypass, and that's what these shunts are for, to bypass certain organs that are not fully matured yet. To bypass the hepatic circulation, ductus venosus allows the umbilical vein to drain into the IVC. Number two. Most oxygenated blood reaching the heart via the inferior vena cava is diverted through the foramen ovale, which is between the two atria, pumped out of the aorta to the head and body. Deoxygenated blood from the superior vena cava expelled into the pulmonary artery, and then the lungs haven't developed yet, so shunts into the ductus arteriosus to the lower body of the fetus. There's nothing to memorize here, just think of how these blood vessels are coming into the heart. Inferior vena cava coming into the heart inferiorly, so therefore will enter the foramen ovale. Superior vena cava via gravity is coming from the superior direction, so therefore will be pumped out through the pulmonary artery ductus arteriosus and then into the lower body of the fetus. At birth, infant takes a breath. What happens? Decreased resistance in pulmonary vasculature causes increased left atrial pressure versus right atrial pressure. Foramen ovale closes, now called the fossa ovalis. Increase in oxygen leads to decrease in prostaglandins, causing closure of ductus arteriosus. Therefore, indomethacin, which is a cyclooxygenase inhibitor, reducing the synthesis of prostaglandins, helps to close PDA, patent ductus arteriosus. Prostaglandin analogs, such as misoprostol, will help to keep the PDA open. Regional specification of developing brain. Once again, please orient yourself with the illustration. We have the prosencephalon, mesencephalon, rhombencephalon. Prosencephalon comprised of telencephalon, diencephalon. The telencephalon made up of cerebral hemispheres. Diencephalon, the thalami. Mesencephalon, midbrain. Rhombencephalon broken down into metencephalon and myelencephalon. And if you wish, take a look at the brainstem structures, which include midbrain, mesencephalon, pons and cerebellum, metencephalon, medulla, myelencephalon. And since this is a review, you should know that those are in descending order. And as far as its primitive structure, moves in alphabetical order. Mesencephalon, M-E-S, metencephalon, M-E-T, myelencephalon, M-Y. The cavities include lateral ventricles for the cerebral hemispheres, third ventricle for the thalami, aqueduct of Sylvius, and then the fourth ventricle for the cerebellum. Neural tube defects. Issues with folate metabolism. Neural pores fail to fuse. Approximately fourth week. What do we know about the fourth week? Rule of fours. Four chambers, heart. Four limb, buds. Persistent connection between amniotic cavity and spinal canal. Associated with low folic acid intake during pregnancy. Elevated alpha fetoprotein in amniotic fluid and maternal serum. Increased alpha fetoprotein plus acetylcholinesterase, which is an enzyme that breaks down acetylcholine, in cerebrospinal fluid. Spina bifida occulta. Failure of bony spinal canal to close, but no structural herniation. Usually seen at lower vertebral levels, dura is intact. Once again, I repeat, dura is intact. Meningocele, no, don't memorize these. Cele is a cavity. Meningo, meninges. Therefore, meningocele, meninges herniate through a spinal canal defect. Myelomeningocele, myelo referring to the spinal cord, meningo, meninges, cele, cavity. Therefore, myelomeningocele, meninges and spinal cord herniate through the spinal canal defect. Please take a look at the image below. Normal, we have the dura mater, meninges, spinal cord, transverse process. We are moving from anterior to posterior, bottom to top. Spina bifida occulta, structural abnormalities, no herniation. Meningocele, the meninges herniate. Myelomeningocele, it's not just the meninges, but also the myelo, meaning or referring to spinal cord. Forebrain anomalies. Anencephaly, malformation of anterior end of neural tube, no brain, calvarium, elevated alpha fetoprotein, what was seen earlier with neural tube defects as well. Polyhydramnios, no swallowing center in brain, so therefore cannot swallow the amniotic fluid that surrounds the fetus, so therefore there is abundance of amniotic fluid. Polyhydramnios. Holopresencephaly, decreased separation of hemispheres across the midline, so therefore it's one continuous cortex, results in cyclopia, associated with Pateau syndrome, severe fetal alcohol syndrome, and cleft lip palate issues. Posterior fossa malformations. Chiari 2. Cerebellar tonsils herniate through foramen magnum with aqueductal stenosis and hydrocephaly. So there is aqueductal stenosis. Hydrocephaly. Often presents with syringomyelia, thoracolumbar myelomeningocele, spinal cord meninges herniating through. Dandy Walker, large posterior fossa, absent cerebellar vermis with cystic enlargement of fourth ventricle, can lead to hydrocephalus and spina bifida. Syringomyelia, enlargement of the central canal of spinal cord. So please picture that in your mind. Take a look at the illustration on the left. Crossing fibers of spinothalamic tract are typically damaged first. Ascending fibers, spinothalamic pain and temperature. Cape-like, quote-unquote, bilateral loss of pain and temperature sensation in upper extremities with preservation of touch sensation. Touch sensation, dorsal column. In the margin, syrinx in Greek refers to tube, as in syringe. associated with Chiari 2 malformation, most common at C8 through T1. Aortic arch derivatives develop into the arterial system. Please refer to the illustration. First, part of maxillary artery, branch of external carotid. Second, stapedial artery and hyoid artery. Third, common carotid artery and proximal part of internal carotid artery. Fourth, on left, aortic arch. On the right, it would be the proximal part of the right subclavian artery. Think about that for a second, please. On the left, aortic arch, and on the right, it would be the proximal part, right subclavian. Sixth, proximal part of pulmonary arteries and, on the left only, anatomically speaking, ductus arteriosus. Remember, it was one of the shunts from the pulmonary trunk to the arch of aorta. The mnemonic that may help with this, first arch is maximal, second is stapedial, C is the third letter of the alphabet, fourth arch, four limbs, therefore systemic, sixth arch equals pulmonary and the pulmonary to systemic shunt, ductus arteriosus. This now completes part two of First Aid Embryology. If you feel as though further information is required, please refer to Falcon Online.